Welcome to On My Way to Wealth, the podcast where busy Gen Xers can learn financial tips as they navigate life on their way to wealth. And now, please join your host, Luis Rosa.
Hello, everyone. Welcome to another episode of On My Way to Wealth. My name is Luis Rosa, and I'm your host. Thank you for tuning in. Today, I want to talk to you about health insurance plans. I know it's not a fun subject per se, but I think it's a very important one that can save you a lot of money. A lot of us only deal with it during open enrollment when we have a job, but some of us deal with it more during the year because we might have switched jobs or maybe our spouse got a new job and they have a new health insurance plan that might work out better for us. So that comes up a lot sometimes during the year. So let's dive right in. You know, before you make a decision on a health insurance plan, you have to take a lot of factors into consideration to see what option works best for you. One thing that you'll notice initially, let's say if it's with an employer that you're getting your insurance through, you're going to notice that a lot of plans are what they call HMOs, and you also see another one called PPO. So I wanted to talk a little bit about the differences between the two, because I feel like this is a great starting point for you to say, okay, first I'm going to go either with an HMO or a PPO if you have those two options. And then from there, you choose a plan that benefits you. And I'll talk a lot about what goes into those plans. So let's get into the differences between HMOs and PPOs. HMO, it stands for Health Maintenance Organization. And PPO is Preferred Provider Organizations. So let me tell you a little bit about the differences. The HMO, you basically, you have a gatekeeper, which is your primary care physician. So you have to have a primary care physician that is in the network of that particular plan. And network means it's just a network of doctors and providers that have contracted with that particular insurance company to provide services for those patients. So if you have an HMO, you have to see your primary care physician before you go see anyone else. So for example, let's say you have a problem with your foot that your primary care physician cannot fix, you still must go to your primary care physician. They take a look at you and then they make a referral out to somebody else within the HMO network, right? So there are some limitations. Now, it's typically a lower premium because you are being confined to that particular network when compared to a PPO, where basically with the PPO, you don't even have to necessarily go see your primary care physician to go see a specialist. You know, you could just do that without a referral, you know, with some exceptions. But for the most part, you have more freedom when it comes to that PPO plan. You know, so one of the things you need to consider is where you live. You know, if you live in an area, you know, some people live in rural areas where maybe there might not be too many doctors in the area contracted with that particular company. So you want to consider that. Also, you might already feel comfortable with your existing doctor. So you want to make sure that they accept your insurance. You want to see if they are, in fact, in network. And if they're not, you also have the option to go out of network with your PPO. And I'm going to talk about that because that's going to impact the cost of the insurance, you know, but at least you do have the option of stepping outside of that network when you are in a PPO. So let's talk about some of the important keywords that go into making a plan. You know, so once you decided, okay, I'm either going to do HMO or PPO, now let's talk about how the mechanism works inside that particular health plan. The one thing you want to know is, you know, and think about it this way, this is a policy just like you would examine a car insurance policy, for example, or a homeowner's insurance policy that has all these different deductibles and co-payments and so on and so forth. You know, it's all a coverage thing that insurance companies set up, and you have to analyze it to see what makes sense for you. So let's talk about the first thing. The first keyword I wanted to talk to you about was deductible. And that's basically the amount you owe for covered healthcare services before your health insurance or plan begins to pay. So think about it in terms of car insurance, right? You'll notice that you have a deductible with your car insurance, which say it's $1,000. So if you're in an accident and your car gets banged up and the cost to repair these, you know, whatever happened to your car, say it's $3,000. If your insurance policy, your car insurance policy has a $1,000 deductible, that means that you have to pay the $1,000 out of pocket, and then the insurance will cover the difference, right? So it's the same exact thing when it comes to health insurance. You also have a deductible. So that's one of the things that you must look at, because sometimes we get very fixated on the price of something. In this case, the price of the insurance policy will be the monthly premium that you pay. But sometimes, depending on how often you think you might need these services, you may in fact be better off with a higher premium health insurance policy as opposed to a lower premium policy, just because of the coverage that you get. You know, your higher premium policy may have a lower deductible. It might provide for more doctors in the network, et cetera. So you have to look at the overall picture. There's also a co-payment, also known as the copay, right? Every time you go to the doctor or a provider, you are required to pay a share of the cost in the form of a co-payment. So you might visit a specialist, might be $50, your standard might be $25 or $30, you know, depending on your policy. So that's one thing to consider. So, you know, if you are in a situation where you see that you are in fact going to the doctor a lot and you anticipate that you will continue to do so, it might make sense, again, to compare a plan that has a lower out-of-pocket expense, even if it's a higher premium, because when you do the math, a lower premium might save you money in the short term, but then when you add up all your deductibles, your co-payments, et cetera, it might end up being more money. So that's one of the decisions that you need to make, you know, and that's one of the things that, as part of their financial planning, I also help my clients with when I'm sitting down with them and going over their policies, because these things impact your out-of-pocket expenses overall, right? So be sure to consult with your financial planner about these kinds of things as well. You know, it's not just about investments and stuff. There's so many different things that impact your pocket, right? Also, another very important thing you need to know about your plan is the concept of co-insurance. Basically, you share the cost of a covered healthcare service, usually calculated as a percentage of the allowed amount of the service. So, for example, you might notice that your policy says that the co-insurance is 80-20. And all that means is that the insurance company would pay 80% of the cost of something, and you would pay the other 20%. You know, so if a procedure costs $1,000, you have to pay your co-payment, your deductible, and then the difference gets split 80-20, you know, and that gives you a really good idea as to how much out-of-pocket you would have. You know, so if you're planning on having a medical procedure done, a surgery, these are the kinds of things that you need to understand so that you can expect reasonably what you might have to pay out-of-pocket. You know, don't think that because you are paying a monthly premium to your insurance company, that these services are going to be 100% covered. So before you make a major decision on some sort of procedure, these are one of the things that you want to consider. Say, okay, ask the doctor or the facility, how much does this procedure cost? Can you give me a breakdown? Then once you have that figure, then you want to log into your health insurance policy or download a copy and look at it. Okay, out of this cost, I have to pay a $1,000 deductible. I also have to pay the co-payment, and then my insurance covers 80% of the difference. And then you can calculate so that you can reasonably expect what to pay for that, right? So it's not a surprise. You want to make sure that you plan ahead of these things. One reason I also mentioned this too is because there is also a maximum out-of-pocket amount that you would pay based on the policy. The policy also has limits. So it would say something like, okay, you may have to pay your deductible and your co-pays, but there is a limit of how much money you would have out of pocket overall in that year. So to give you an example, if your policy has a $3,000 maximum out of pocket, that means that once you've met that $3,000 minimum, and usually you can count your co-pays and your deductible towards that, after that $3,000, then the insurance will pay for 100% of the cost of any procedures that you might have, you know. So then you have to consider that, because sometimes it might be a planning opportunity. You know, if you look at the year has gone by and you've already met your deductible and you're on the fence about waiting to have a procedure maybe next year, you might want to consider doing it this year, because now if you do that, because you've met your full out-of-pocket maximum, it may make sense to do it this year, and then you can go ahead and have that procedure taken care of by the insurance company because it's on a year-by-year basis. So if you met your maximum out of pocket for one calendar year, then it's going to restart again next year because the policy term was just that 1 year, you know, so, and that could mean thousands of dollars, right? Another thing to take into account is the maximum out of pocket. If you are a couple, typically there is a family maximum as well. So one of the individuals in the policy, you don't have to meet both. So, you know, the maximum out of pocket might be say $6,000 and it could be 3,000 each for the two spouses. So again, something else to take into consideration because there is an individual limit and then there's a maximum limit for the family as well. So, you know, these are, you know, could be complicated, but at the end of the day, it's just an insurance policy, just like a car insurance or homeowner's insurance. That you just want to make sure you understand all these different deductibles, co-payments, co-insurance, maximum out-of-pockets, premiums, who's in network, who isn't, you know. It's really what it comes down to. So how do you take advantage of certain things? You know, a lot of insurance companies also offer free preventive services that they're just covered automatically by the policy. So this could be screening tests, certain vaccine shots. You know, you want to make sure that you understand what those are and then take advantage of them because then you can get a lot of stuff that's already included in the plan without you having to pay extra for them. You know, that could also apply to certain mental health and substance abuse services as well. So definitely want to consult that part of the policy. Now, to take further advantage of your policy, there are things that you can do in conjunction with your policy because there are some tax savings opportunities as well that you can do. You know, if you are employed and your employer offers, for example, what's called a flexible spending account, FSA for short, you can take advantage of that because let's say that you anticipate you will have several amount of visits to the doctor during the year, out-of-pocket expenses, right? Like for things like your co-payments and prescriptions, you can get a flexible spending account through if your employer offers that as a benefit. And in essence, what it does is you can put money pre-tax into this account and you get a debit card that you can use when you go to the doctor or to the pharmacy and you give them that debit card and you swipe, now you're paying for these expenses with pre-tax dollars, you know, so that could be a pretty big savings. Now, one thing to keep in mind about flexible spending account is that they have like a use it or lose it clause where you have to use the amount of money that you put into the account before the year is out. Otherwise, you lose it. It doesn't roll over into the next year. You know, so one thing to consider, you don't want to overfund it either because then you might end up losing out, right? So, but if you time it properly, you use it properly, you can take great advantage of these tax savings opportunities. Another major one is a lot of the times you might see that your employer offers what's called a high deductible health insurance plan. If you have a high deductible health insurance plan, then you can take advantage of what's called an HSA, it's a health savings account. Now, let me tell you a little bit about that. Now, why would you take a high deductible health insurance plan? You know, if you're relatively healthy and you don't expect to have too many out-of-pocket, too many like visits to the doctor, you know, if you don't have anything going on with you, don't expect anything, right? And you know, maybe you just go to the doctor once or twice a year for like your general checkup and stuff, and you don't really need a lot of coverage. You know, one option that you could choose is a high deductible health insurance plan if that's offered through your employer. And what that does is, you know, typically you will have a lower premium as a result because you're not going to be using it as much, right? And the coverage is not going to be as much. But one of the advantages of that, and this is another thing that you can speak to your financial planner about, is opening up a health savings account has triple tax advantages if you use it properly. Basically, as an individual for 2021, you can contribute a maximum of $3,600. If you do a family plan, it's $7,200. And if you're age 55 or older, you could do an additional $1,000 catch-up contribution to these amounts. So think about it this way. You could have your health insurance plan, then a health savings account, where you contribute money on a pre-tax basis to this HSA, and then you can use that money to pay for your out-of-pocket expenses. Now, how does this differ from the FSA? The fact that several ways. One is you can put more money into this. Number two, it actually does roll over to the next year, so you don't lose whatever you don't use. And the triple tax advantage is that you're putting pre-tax money into it. The money gets to grow tax-free. You could actually either save it or invest it in the HSA. And also, when you take the money out, if it's for qualified medical expenses, it comes out tax-free. You know, now a lot of these people, a lot of people use this as a planning opportunity for the future and fund their HSAs, even if they don't plan on having a need for medical expenses right now, because you get to lower your taxable income in essence by contributing to this health savings account. Max it out, let it grow, right? If you end up not needing it, after age 65, you can take the money out. You'll pay taxes on it, but you won't have the penalty, which right now, if you take the money out and it's not for medical expenses, there's a 20% penalty in addition to taxable income. So something else to consider, right? So if you have the means to max this out or contribute to one, you want to make sure that you plan properly so that when you do take money out, it's for qualified medical expenses, so that you take advantage of the fact that then it'll be tax-free and penalty-free. If you take it out and it's for something else other than medical expenses, you will be hit with 20% penalty. So that could be pretty hefty. So again, speak to your financial planner about that. But that is one way to take advantage, right? Another way that you can take advantage, if you are a couple and you both get offered health insurance, you might benefit, depending on your situation, from having dual coverage, where you are covered under your insurance plan at work and maybe your spouse's as well. Because what happens is, it's they call it a coordination of benefits, where basically one policy would cover up to certain limits. And once those limits are exhausted, the second policy would kick in. You know, so you want to make sure that you understand how that works for you. And then obviously consider the premiums that you're paying and see if it makes sense. You know, so some people that are relatively healthy right now, they don't have a lot of need to go to the doctor often, or they're not on any medication, it may just make sense to have a lower premium cost, maybe get a high deductible savings plan, put money into a health savings account. You know, if you have a condition, you need prescriptions, you need to go to the doctor often, you might be better off with a higher premium. So don't focus so much only on the premium. You want to make sure that you have proper coverage, you know. And again, I bring that back to auto insurance policy, because most of us have one. It's the same thing, right? I remember when I was a kid, you know, just beginning to drive, like say a kid, but like, you know, teenager, 17, 18, when I first got my license, you know, all you could afford is like the minimum liability, right? So you get like the cheapest possible policy out there with the smallest premium. But in reality, like if I was to get into a car accident, I'll have very little liability coverage, right? So you don't want to leave yourself hanging out to dry either, because you have to consider other factors other than just cost when it comes to these things. So maybe one day I'll do an episode on health savings contributions all by itself, you know, because I think it's a very important topic. And a lot of times people just don't know about it or don't use it, you know, which is yet another benefit of sitting down with a financial planner that can look at your overall situation and not just, you know, investing or anything like that. Like there's so much more out there that you can help yourself save money and invest and save for your future. So I hope that you learn a little something about health insurance, and the next time around that you're up with that decision, this helps you in terms of deciding what might be best for you. If you have any questions, send me an email at luis@onmywaytowealth.com. Thank you all for tuning in, and I'll see you in the next episode. Thank you for listening to On My Way to Wealth. If you have any questions, please send me an email at luis@onmywaytowealth.com. The information provided here is for information and education purposes only. The opinions expressed herein are solely those of myself, unless otherwise specifically cited. Material presented is believed to be from reliable sources, and no representations are made by my firm or myself about other parties' information or accuracy or completeness. All information or ideas provided should be discussed in detail with a financial advisor, accountant, or legal counsel prior to implementation. Thank you.